Now, Quantrill came down Massachusetts, heading north, and he got to the Eldridge House. Now, this isn't the original building, but it is the original location. Now, Quantrill believed at this point he was in for a battle because this was the head of the militia. And so they surrounded this building here, believing that it was going to be an unbelievable battle. But to their surprise, it wasn't at all. That the commander at this location basically raised a window and gave him a white flag of surrender. And so what they thought was going to be a battle was not. Now, the armory was located across the street. So there was the armory here. Now, the gentleman that had the key was shot dead, so they never ever even got the armory unlocked. Now, one of the funny things about it also is that there was a rule in this town that you couldn't have a gun. So how crazy is that? So all of the guns were locked up in the building that would have been the armory. So Quantrill leaves here looking for Lane, because Lane was the prize, because he had been causing havoc in Missouri for a long, long time. But he had already escaped into a cornfield. Now, how I understand it is, one thing Quantrill's men would not do was follow you into the cornfield. So they got Quantrill back here to tell him that, you know, there was a pharmacy in the basement of this building and that they were afraid it was going to blow up. So he did take the prisoners. Now, they marched all of the residents of this hotel down to the bottom floors and robbed them. And then eventually the building did catch fire and burn to the ground. So what Quantrill believed was going to be one of the biggest fights was no fight at all. So he had made it to downtown Lawrence basically unscathed, which was kind of unbelievable when he figured that this was going to be an unreal battle at this point was none at all, which is pretty amazing when you think about it. One of the major things to think about when Quantrill rode down Massachusetts Avenue is that they pretty much were shooting anybody that resisted at all. The word basically came out that if you were old enough to hold a gun, then to shoot you as far as the males. Now, they spared all the females. So when you look down this road, you would have saw bodies along these sidewalks, because they were shooting anybody that was out and about. So one of the things to remember is that it was a turmoil, and they would have heard them coming at the Eldridge House when they came down here, which might have been one of the reasons that they surrendered so easily, was because they had already, you know, been on a murder spree up and down this road. So that might have been one of the main reasons that they basically, when they got to this location where they thought they were going to have a problem, they probably would be able to see out of these windows too the amount of guerrillas that were in the area, which they say was up to as high as 400. So that might have been one of the reasons that they did not even try to put up a fight at this location. Now, the people in the hotel surrendered, and so part of the surrender was that they would be guaranteed their safety. So Quantrill decided to take them down to the City Hotel, which is down at 6th in Massachusetts. Now, the thing to remember about Quantrill is he spent time here. He was a teacher here. So he knew a lot of the people, and he knew the individual that owned the City Hotel. So while this hotel was on fire, they then evacuated all the people out of that building, and they took them to the City Hotel. You know, so they brought the people to this location. Nathan Stone was the guy that ran this. Now, remember the history with Quantrill. He was from this area where he taught school. So this was a friend of his. So basically he told his raiders that this place was off limits. But there was one drunken guerrilla that didn't believe that. It was Larkin Skaggs. And Larkin Skaggs had stolen a ring from one of the daughters of Stone. And Quantrill found out and he was livid. So he made him take it back. Well, that didn't sit too well with Skaggs. So after Quantrill had left, a drunken Larkin Skaggs came back to this location. And he then killed Stone. He was so drunk that the townspeople came and they got him and they dismembered him right here in the street. And so he was one of the very few people that got killed in this raid on the guerrilla side. And one of the problems that they had was all these guerrillas came extremely intoxicated and they become unruly. And so that's really what happened, is once they took this town over because of their drunkenness was why there was a real situation. So on this very location right here was where Larkin Skaggs was eliminated, as well as Stone. You know, at the corner here, you see the riverfront now on down below. You know, there was a ferry that would come across that river, the Kansas River. And Quantrill sent 15 men across over there to keep people, you know, the Union who were over there, that were firing over this direction, kept them from coming across the ferry. So he seized the ferry, basically. You know, once Quantrill believed that he had control of the city of Lawrence, he sent a large party over to 745 Vermont Street, because on this corner was the Johnson Hotel. And the Johnson Hotel was infamous because this was the headquarters of the Red Legs. And the Red Legs were a violent group of border ruffians that had really caused severe damage to the state of Missouri along the border. So his goal was to try to capture this location and burn it to the ground. We'd be right now on the west side of the square. So if you'll see this ravine down here and you'll look along here, what you're gonna see is a ravine. Now, when the raid was going on, the townspeople ran down to this ravine and the raiders were very hesitant to come down in here. So they actually let them be. So if you were able to get down here into this location, then you might be safe. I mean, can you just imagine what this would have been like with all the bloodshed going on and coming down this direction and the people fleeing for their lives down into this ravine? And it would have been a different deal now, wouldn't it, down in here? You know, next Quantrill rode across what used to be a bridge down here up to this house right here, which would have been 516 6th Street. And what you would have found right there was the mayor's house. Now the mayor knew that they were coming, and him and his aide got in the well. Now there was only one problem though. Quantrill caught that house on fire, and they didn't leave until the house completely burned. But the mayor and his aide died in that well. Now, the sad part about that is not only did they die, another person came to look for them, got down in there to try to find them. The rope broke. They went down in there, and they also suffocated in the same well. So three men died right across that street that probably Quantrill didn't even realize that he killed. So it's just amazing the amount of death and destruction in this town. And you look up these tree-lined streets, and you just see how beautiful these houses are. But on that fateful day, a lot of those houses got caught on fire. Look at that fence. That's pretty cool. That's pretty old too. I didn't think it was until I saw that iron on the top. That iron on the top's ancient. You know, as you look around here, the first thing you start to notice is, you know, how beautiful these older homes are. And then you stumble across this marker, you know, let me kind of get an idea as you look down the streets. And then you get an idea and you look at this marker that's kind of precariously just set right here. This says that Griswold, Baker, and Thorpe and Trask were shot August 21st, 1863 on this very location. The word was that they went to the house and they told them to come out and they wouldn't hurt them and they surrendered. And then I guess they decided that they weren't walking fast enough and he decided, well, that one way to get rid of them, to make them walk faster, is just to kill them, I guess. So they shot them right on that location. Can you imagine all the stuff that was going on as this massacre was happening and all the chaos that had been going on and the fact that, you know, there were 400 riders up and down these streets. You know, they're calling people out of their homes. And it would have been an incredible sight to see and one that the people of Lawrence would... some say never forget. Now look at these beautiful homes here in these locations now. Through here. This beautiful house here. Look at these beautiful homes all the way down this boulevard. Now one thing Darren was showing me is these are the original sidewalks. This is a slab. This has not been laid or poured. It's been laid but not poured. So these sidewalks have been here, you know, since way back. And it's kind of intriguing that these old neighborhoods like this still hold. And they've done such a beautiful job of restoring most of these buildings. I mean, look at how beautiful this one is here. That's just unbelievable. And the commitment it takes and the money that it takes to do this is unbelievable. It's such a peaceful day today, but it sure wasn't a peaceful day on August 21st. Look at this spectacular house that is still standing from the time of the raid. This is the Hoyt house. This was a boarding house back in those days. Now, when Quantrill dispatched his guerrillas out to go find Lane, they passed this very location. And the reason that this house didn't get destroyed was that the keeper at that point said that an old widowed woman owned this location. And therefore, they spared this house. Look at this thing. Can you believe what this house has seen? How incredible this place is. Look at this beautiful house. This house is unreal. And can you imagine, you know, these guerrillas coming down this street? Because, you know, look how cool this house would even look then. You know, because look how neat it did. It would have looked actually probably a little neater because it would have been newer. But look how beautiful it looks now even. You know, all these years later. But because the gentleman inside lied and said a widowed woman owned it, that was one lie worth telling. You know, today you see the old postman walking down here on this tree-laden road and how beautiful it is. But if you can imagine on August 21st, and if you can imagine, you know, less trees, and you would have probably been able to see downtown Lawrence, and you probably would have been able to see the smoke. And I mean, you would have heard guns going off nonstop. And it would have been a whole different world back then. And you would have been pretty fearful of your life just to see if you were going to survive this. But I mean, the whole thing would have been unreal from the time that they rolled in the AM to the time that they finally in the PM rolled out of here. You know, we're on the corner of Mississippi and 8th. And this was the target location of a guy named James Lane. Now, James Lane was who they were really after. James Lane had spent a life, you know, planning and plotting and sending troops and people to Missouri to cause just the kind of same havoc that was happening here in Lawrence that day. So he was a big target, and his house was right in this vicinity on 8th and Mississippi. And on down was a cornfield. And the amazing thing about the guerrillas is that we find out they were very hesitant to either go into ditches or go into cornfields. And so he made his escape. Now, we saw his tombstone, so we know that he made it because he lasted it out, and he lived a longer life considering the life that he lived. But look at these beautiful locations, these beautiful homes. I mean, these tree-lined. You know, back then, this would have been fairly barren, and you probably would have definitely been able to see the smoke billowing. He knew stuff was going down. The guy knew that, you know, if he wanted to make it out of here, he better run. You know, here's a funny story that Darren was telling me about the Lane house. So he hides in the cornfield, she stays, because the guerrillas did not touch the women. And so here's something that's just incredible, and I don't really get it completely, but the guerrillas knew that they had to burn the house down. That was kind of like something they knew they had to do, and they were going to do it, but they helped her unload the goods out of the house before they burn it down. So there's a lot of weird kind of chivalry that you kind of don't get. And, you know, maybe it really comes down to, you know, the reality of it was they understood they were both, you know, in reality fighting for their own cause, and that they might be at the other end of that at one time in their life. Is the only thing I can figure. Now, the crazy thing that happened in this Lawrence massacre was that the women started to figure out that they weren't going to be more than harassed, and they turned the tables on the guerrillas. They started harassing the guerrillas and really pushing them, and it was probably incredible, and they're probably the ones that actually helped get rid of Quantrill and his men faster, because they had the courage to stand up to these guys. But then again, they also realized that they weren't in danger, you know. So it's pretty incredible to think that, you know, a lot of these women in mourning whose husbands and children have been killed, you know, turned the table on these people. Sure doesn't look like the site of a massacre here as we walk through these streets of Lawrence, Kansas, does it? Some of the most beautiful homes that I have come across. You know, here's a house here that belonged to the Bell family. And the husband went off to try to fight these guerrillas. And they left Mary Bell alone in this house with her 6 children. And the guerrillas tried to catch fire to this 7 times. With no luck, she and her children were able to put it out. Isn't that incredible that this house still stands because of the work that in saving this house? Now, the sad part of this story is he was found and killed, but she was able to save this house, the George and Annie Bell house, founded in 1863, which is pretty incredible. Look at this place. You know, even though it doesn't fit the size of a lot of the other ones that we've come across, there's something really special about that one. Maybe the determination of the woman that lived there to save it for her and her family. And you know how difficult that would have been being up against these guys. I mean, these were tough guys, the toughest around. And the fact that she was able to save this house so it still stands today is incredible to me. The amount of courage that she showed to make sure that this house stood so me and you can look at it all these years later. you know, what is that, 160 years old, something like that. I don't think my house is going to stand that long, but look at that. That's incredible. What an incredible journey we have had walking these side streets of Kansas. You know, when Quantrill finally left that day, I'll tell you what, Missouri and Kansas would never be the same. You know, all those people dead, Order 11 after that. Unreal. I mean, it was really unreal, and it heightened the bloodbath of that time. And then there was also a point where they also said that anybody that was a guerrilla was a common thief and that they should be executed at the spot. So how incredible is this story of how this changed all these people's lives? Not, you know, I mean, husbands lost, fatherless children. You know, it was incredible how devastating the entire war was. And you know, slavery was this much of that. It was so much more. You could not be on a side regardless if you liked it or not, because you were getting berated by one side or the other. So you had to make a choice, whether it be a good choice or a bad choice, that you're gonna have to side up with somebody regardless of what the theory was and what, regardless if you thought that was what you wanted to be. So, you know, we're gonna leave this day in Lawrence, Kansas on this beautiful July day, thinking in the August 21st, how unreal the violence and the bloodshed was in this town. And it changed history forever. Thanks for coming along. If you'd like to donate to Patreon, you like this kind of stuff, so we can travel all over the country bringing history to you, please donate. Like, subscribe. Jace Rec, I'm out with Darren today, and we were at Lawrence, Kansas on the trail of Quantrill.